I'm Chris Cuffaro, and this is the State of the Love and Trust. Welcome, everyone, to another episode of The State of Love and Trust. It's a Pearl Jam podcast, and I'm one of your two hosts, Jason Kerepesi, and alongside me, as always, is
Paul Ghiglieri.
Paul, we have a hell of a show today. To say that we have stories is an understatement.
It's true.
You guys may not know this, but sometimes when we do interviews, we record this part after the interview. We just had the interview. And there are stories. Before we get to those stories, though, I need to remind you of the most important stuff. For us, it is to like and subscribe to this video and channel on YouTube. Hit the bell for notifications. And if you are an old school podcaster listening audio only, Paul, what should they do?
They should rate, review, and subscribe on their preferred podcast platform of choice. Feed that algorithm. It's the right thing to do.
Absolutely. The better thing to do is to actually go ahead and scan that QR code that's on your screen right now, or click the link in the description of the show or the link in our social media bio. Actually, I think it's our Instagram bio. That would help you. That would help us. That would help the Trevor Project, and that they champion and support the LGBTQ plus community. That is our fundraiser of June. And it would be super cool of you to donate a few bucks over there. $5 or more gets you a sticker and pin pack from us, or and or $5 off one of our t-shirts. I'm wearing one right now. There it is.
It's a beaut, Jason.
And that would be super helpful. We'd really appreciate that. If you want to support this show a little bit more, there is Patreon, whole bunch of extra content. We do have giveaways as well. This guy, Long Road, Pearl Jam, Stephen Hyden. Paul is pointing to the other way.
No, I was pointing right at you, actually.
Oh, you were? You were in reverse. So you can win that if you are a patron in the month of June. That is all we're going to say because there is so much to get to with legendary photographer, director, filmmaker, app maker? Oh my God, wait and find out. Chris Cuffaro. He's a legendary photographer who shot the likes of George Michael, Iggy Pop, Jane's Addiction, Soundgarden, Elvis Costello, Pearl Jam, and countless other musicians, actors, athletes, and more. He's been snapping iconic images and directing iconic video and film for damn near 50 years. We welcome to the show, Chris Cuffaro.
Yeah, I'm old. Sad.
And that's your episode. Thank you. Goodnight.
Yeah, exactly. I'm telling you guys, I literally was, before we got on this, I was scanning some pictures from 1986. And I sent a copy to my friends. I'm like, where were you in 86? And they all respond, I wasn't born yet. I'm like, fuck you. So
it was four. Like they'll never know Christie Brinkley like we know Christie Brinkley.
No, exactly. I started shooting in 1970. I started my business in 72.
So you would say they'll never know Bo Derek like you know Bo Derek then.
Exactly. And I have the original Playboy edition of Bo Derek, and I got to meet her and hang out with her a few times.
There you go.
Was she a 10 then too?
Yeah, she's always, look at her now. She's still a 10. Still a 10. She looks amazing for her age.
I don't want to start back at the beginning because I'm sure you're sick of that. But like, let's start with your big break shooting George Michael on the Faith Tour. And you said that he taught you how to have fun. So how does Chris Cuffaro have fun?
Well, drugs. Before George, I never did drugs or got drunk. I've been a workaholic since I was probably 5. And then I started photography at 10 and nothing. I still have lived by the motto, work first, play later. So touring with George and on the Faith Tour and stuff like that with my friends, for friends of mine, I got exposed to things that I'd never thought I would, imagined. And then I got exposed to, at the beginning, was ecstasy. And that just broke all these crazy strict rules and walls that I had around me, melted away. And I went, oh, this is what fun can be. And, and I grew up in the Bay Area. If you guys know the Bay Area, but I grew up in the Bay Area. And I was like, the analogy I use is, from 60 to 70, right? The 60s. I'm 5 years old and 65, six, eight and 68, whatever. I have a brother 10 years older than me. And I was living vicariously through him, and he went to Monterey Pop and Altamont and all, you know, the hippie stuff. I was on the fringe of it, exposed to it through him.
So I've got to ask you then, Chris, because I mean, I'm from San Francisco, right? Yeah. Let's talk Bill Graham for a second.
Oh, God.
Right? I've seen a lot of shows at the Bill Graham Civic Auditorium, and I'd love you to elaborate a little bit on your love of that scene, Bill Graham's impact on it, and how you got working with him.
Well, I did. What it was okay. So since I picked up a camera, I wanted to be a fast photographer, right? So I wanted to be Richard Avedon. That's all I ever wanted, and still do to this day. But in 76, I went to my first concert at the Berkeley Community Theater. You ever been there?
No, I know about the Day at the Green.
Yeah, exactly. The Day at the Greens, but yeah. So, but I went to Berkeley Community Theater in 1976 to see Return to Forever, which was a jazz fusion band with Chick Corea, Al Di Meola, Stanley Clarke, and Lenny White. Ooh. 1976. I always like to tell people, I grew up in the barrios, the hood. So I didn't grow up.
Call that the Mission?
Well, no, I grew up in San Jose, East San Jose. No, that's true. We used to pronounce it San Jose High because it was Spanish, Mexican. And I grew up with lowriders and the whole thing. Again, any story I say, people watching this, I got pictures to prove it. I ain't making shit up. I always tell people I was rolling in 6'4s before most people were.
Before easy. So,
but like music in the Bay Area, as you know, Bill Graham. It was everything was Bill Graham, you know, like the Circle Star Theater, the Cow Palace, the Fillmore, go down the Oakland Coliseum. You know, I saw Earth, Wind & Fire 6 times. New Year's Eve, 1978, I saw Journey and Blondie opening. Ooh. You know, Steve Perry at the peak, at the beginning of Infinity. And so I have a list. You can go to my website and see the list of all the concerts I saw in high school. And most of it was R&B, funk, and jazz fusion. I saw some rock concerts like the Doobie Brothers and Fleetwood Mac and the Beach Boys at the Cow Palace. So, you know, that was a big music was, I always tell people, if you give me the option to be a musician or photographer, I would have chosen musician. And yeah, I started shooting concerts in 76 and then, you know, sneaking.
That's when Rumors came out, right?
Yeah, exactly. Great. And sneaking my camera in was the deal. Like you sneak your camera in wherever I sat, I had to shoot from and had a shitty camera, but I didn't think about music photography. I grew up looking at Rolling Stone. I grew up knowing Jim Marshall. I knew who, you know, the music photographers were, Henry Diltz. Who didn't know who Henry Diltz was, you know? So, cause you're looking at album credits. We had packaging, you know? So that was a big deal. And Bill Graham's name was on everything. And you know, all these years later, I never got to meet him, but I shot at some of the shows. And then years later, I got to, on my website, I just dropped my interview with Del Ferrano. Del and Bill, I mean, Del's, I always tell, I have good stories. I always tell people, but when you sit down with Del and my mentor, Michael Littman, these guys' stories make my stories look stupid. like stupid. I have all my ticket stubs to everything I ever did.
Do you? I did that for a long time, but I feel like I forgot.
Oh, did you ever see ELO in San Francisco?
Yes, in Oakland Coliseum.
Oh, nice.
You know, so I grew up with all that, and my brother, who was older, made me listen to, you know, his 60s guy. So he would make me listen to Bob Dylan and Hendrix, and he loved the blues. So I was listening to Muddy Waters and Albert.
You had
Collin.
A very well-rounded upbringing.
Yes,
Chris.
And my mom loved musicals. And then my dad loved, you know, Dean Martin, you know, Sinatra.
You're just ticking all the boxes.
Yeah, I really did. And then my grandparents who lived next door was into classical and opera. So we heard everything, you know. And so I always tell, looking back on it all, I go, there's a reason I started shooting music. It's obvious. It wasn't by accident.
Yeah. Now you've got obviously pretty much everything on your website, chriscuffaro.com. And last year you released, no you don't? You've got a lot of shit on there. I've been scrolling for days.
What the world has seen of my life is about a third. That's the way I'm working this. I've had a plan for my whole life. I live by the quote, a goal without a plan is a wish. Everything I do in life, there's a plan.
All right.
So, and then I like to drop this on the people all the time. I shoot under 5 different alias names that nobody knows. Ooh. That's me. So
care to say any of those right now?
No. And as I've said for the last 25 years, if David Bowie can do Ziggy Stardust, well, then I can do whatever the fuck I want.
Well, you do have this app, this Greatest Hits app that you put out about a year ago.
It's a dream come true.
I'm going to assume that everybody has it. And if they don't, they should go and download it right now. Yes, you can pause the video right now.
It's free.
And then, and you've been updating it with more content all the time. And so you've got like your most iconic photos on there, right? I think it's like the 100. And then you got videos explaining some of those backstories. There's just a ton of content over there. That said, the idea to do this was not even yours.
No.
You ripped off your hero, Chris. Tell me about that.
Yeah. So back in when I started the Greatest Project, Greatest Hits, like 14 years ago, I think. I have to do the math on that. And Avedon Foundation had an app out that I loved, and it was basically exactly what I have, which is photos with story, but no videos, but stories behind the photos, proof sheets and poll, you know, just the little stuff. And so when I started Greatest Hits, that's a crazy story in itself, but I started Greatest Hits because I wanted to, I lost the most important person in my life and to cancer, and that changed everything for me. And so I wanted to celebrate this crazy life of mine. And, you know, as you ask any of my friends that know me, the joke is everybody knows my photos, but they don't know me. And I always say to everybody, I meet people in the middle of the Australian outback and they'll be like, who are you? And I go, you seen this photo? And they go, yeah. And I go, that's me. It's like, I could be in the middle of nowhere and just go, you know this photo? They go, yeah, that's me. So everybody knows the photos. They just don't know it's me. And so I'm trying to change that. My goal is to sit there and, you know, I keep saying to everybody, I just want people to know what I've done, my body of work. So the app is evolving. We're planning a AR VR exhibition for next year. Put your goggles on, be through the whole experience. We were talking about everything from that to doing broadcasting live photo shoots where you can put your goggles on, be immersed in the studio while we're shooting a band or so, you know, an artist. We got lots of big ideas for it, taking the technology of today, you know, old school mixed with new school, if that makes sense.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, going back through decades of photos for this project, which is more than a dozen years in the making at this point. I mean, it's got to obviously bring back some memories, some probably more favorable than others. But so, I mean, I have to ask, you're going through these photos, and at any point did you look at this and say, okay, I blocked that out for so long? Or, you know, were there photos or sets of photos that you had just completely forgotten about?
Well, there were shoots that I would go, oh, that's right, I forgot I did this. You know, I have a really pretty good memory anyway, in general, even the fact that I'm getting older. My joke is, you could ask me, hey, Chris, do you remember anything about shooting Pearl Jam? And I'd be like, that first shoot? I don't remember a fucking thing. But then I look at the photos and I go, oh yeah, right, we did this here. The memories come from the photos. It's like they got locked into there. Then that triggers the memories. And so, so that's what it's been, the joy. I've been archiving now everything for the last, it's almost been 5 years that I'm working on this project. I have another year to go, I'd say. And the idea I have is just to digitally archive everything. So, and I'm doing a good, I'm not lying. I'm home all the time. I have no life. So I'm scanning all the time. I'm scanning shit all the time. And the hard part is finding shoots with bands that I love to do if I find some shoot, and then doing the research and go, where's the band today? And half the members are dead, or, you know, for not even like crazy reasons, but like disease and cancer, like, you know, that's the hard part, is like looking the research, oh man. And then realizing I was part of their life, or even if it was a split second, it kind of makes me feel good. So there's a weird part about that. About 6 months ago, I was scanning the first session I did with Body Count, you know, Ice-T's metal band.
Yep.
And I just looked and there was like 8 guys in the band, and I think half of them are dead now. And it just kind of bums me out. But like, I do tell myself, like, hey, you were part of their lives. You gave them something, and you did something.
Time is undefeated, Chris.
Exactly.
You know, when it comes to life, you say it's necessary for a balance between art and commerce.
Yes.
And we see an imbalance with that now, with music streaming especially.
Yeah. And God, yeah.
So much so that, you know, musicians have to tour and sell merch to make money when it used to be you just sold your music. So talk to us about how you balance art and commerce in an age where the general public is often unwilling to pay for, you know.
It's different now for me. I don't consider myself a working photographer. You know, I just don't. I mean, I shoot all the time and I haven't been paid. I just finally got paid actually 2 weeks ago. I got paid somebody to pay me a few bucks. But
do you think your art's being taken for granted?
No, I think it's just a different world. You know, there's when I moved to LA, there was 10 photographers. Really? I mean, 10, okay, so let me back up. The way I rate things, it's sports analogy, guys. You understand this. There's the major leagues and the minor leagues, right? You can play baseball and you can be in Bakersfield and play baseball and have peanuts and popcorn and play ball and there's a bat and a ball. It's not Pac Bell Park. You know what I mean? It's different. So I look at photographers that way. There's major league photographers. And at the time when I got here, there was about 10, Herb Ritz, Matthew Ralston, Greg Gorman, you know, Paul Jasmine, like gods. And then, you know, then there's another 100 B plus photographers, minor leaguers. I got in the major leagues, as I like to say. I got in the major leagues about 83, 84 when I started working here. Now, for me, it's you know, everybody has their opinions. It's just I have focused on put everything I have into greatest hits because the goals have changed. Just so you know, the original goal was to do 6 exhibitions and call it a day. Now the goal is to do a hell of a lot more exhibitions. And then I want to do the last exhibition. And I'm hoping that's in 2 years. I want to do the last exhibition at Madison Square Garden in New York City.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Which has never been done. So things like that. I tell people I have great mentors now, but I've always had great mentors. When I was a kid, my saying was then, and it is today, go big or shut the fuck up. And I live by that. I also live by do the work, shut the fuck up and do the work, you know? So I always tell, I don't aim, you know, like I always tell people my first exhibition, when was that? 85, I think. It was a tiny little thing, whatever. I was 25 years old, whatever. It was cool. But when we started planning greatest hits, it was like, you know, I had 1,000 people on opening night. We had band performances from my hero, Lauren Ruth Ward, Micah Nelson, Willie Nelson's son. I had Josh from Buck Cherry. I had, you know, 1,000 people. Tower Records on Sunset. I go big. Mm. And that's why Madison Square Garden, people, my friends that know me go, yeah, I can see you doing that. And I'm like, yeah, you want, you'll see. You'll see.
So no point over the years when you've shot me less for the check, did you ever say, Our art is not being.
So my balance. You know what I mean? Yeah, no, my balance of art and commerce. Let's go back in time. I'll use 91 as an example. My balance of 91 was okay. I'm shooting a TV show, getting paid, you know, $15,000-$20,000 fee plus expenses. Yeah, okay, cool. Let's go shoot the show. I did Fresh Prince the first year of Fresh Prince, so all those photos are mine. Get paid good money, NBC. But then you know what? My first trip to Seattle. On a Friday, I fly up EMI to shoot Queensryche, 10K plus expenses, total budget about 20. On a Friday, there to shoot, you know, get paid, man. 10K is a good paycheck. Mm-hmm. Then you know what? I got Saturday off. You know what am I going to do on a Saturday? I got nothing to do. I call up John Silva. Hey, John, is the band around? He goes, yeah, Nirvana. Yeah, they just got a new drummer. Got a kid named Dave. They could use some photos. Great. That Saturday afternoon, I meet them at the diner. I buy them lunch, take good care of them. We go out and shoot for a few hours and thanks guys. And I got to shoot Nirvana. Oh my God. You know, Dave's first shoot. And then since then, those photos have generated some good income thanks to Live Nation, and t-shirts. So I always balanced out like, okay, I've got to go do the job, like the pays the bills and pays my rent. But then I'm going to mix it in. I'm going to go follow Jane's Addiction around for 3 years. I'm flying myself to New York City to see Jane's Addiction do, you know, play Madison Square Garden for the first time. The first band ever to have a mosh pit. Things like that. I had to be there at the first Lollapalooza, especially with Jane's Addiction. I just worship them, still do to this day. And so for me, it was like that balance of, oh, I got to go shoot the dumb job, you know, some dumb TV thing or actor thing or commercial thing. And then just go but like, I got no time, you know, I'm going to go do like these free shoots, like, or magazine shoots paid nothing. You know, I got, you know, going back to Pearl Jam is the start was I was in New York City. They were playing the Sub Pop showcase for CMJ, I think. And they were, I couldn't understand why. I've talked about it in my videos and stuff. I didn't know why they were there with Reverend Horton Heat and I forget who else was there for Sub Pop. And my good friend, the publicist, Julie, I said, hey, what are they doing tomorrow? And she's like, oh, nothing. I go, can we shoot them? It'd be really cool. We'll bring Pearl Jam to the studio. And she's like, okay. And so, you know, in the same day, I shoot the Afghan Wigs and then Pearl Jam.
Nice. So you basically compartmentalized and said, I'll do those silly jobs that don't actually maybe fulfill me as much.
Right.
But they're going to pay for me to go gallivanting with all these bands.
Exactly. What it does is the way I generalize it was I got to, you know, you feed the soul with the free shit.
Right.
And then that fills my soul and makes me feel good. And then I got to pay the bills with the commerce stuff. But I also was smart enough. And I keep saying to everybody, especially the kids I mentor, I knew that shit was going to pay off. I knew, you know, spending my own dime to follow Jane Zichs around was going to pay off. I knew I have things that nobody else has, right? I have images that nobody else was there.
Not everybody's for. That confident, Chris, to say that I think I have something amazing here.
You can ask anybody that's known me. I'll get my best friend on here I've known since we were five. She'll tell you, Chris has always been crazy. And so, but it's like this thing I've always had a vision for my life and my career. And I've had the same goal. One goal, same goal since I was 10. And the simple goal was to create the greatest body of work I can. And so, and you guys can all judge me after I'm gone, you know. And last year was Richard Avedon's 100th birthday. And I've saw many of his exhibitions and stuff when he was alive. But last year they celebrated his 100th birthday. And some of the exhibitions they did were amazing. And, you know, his images make me cry because they just, I'm doing what I'm doing because of him.
One of the things that you've said is you either play the game or you get played.
Right.
So speaking of the soul, I mean, a lot of people, creative people, politics of business, achieving success, a lot of that stuff, it's important, if not more so than the work itself for some folks. Right. Do you personally like playing the game, or is it just part of the process? It's a necessary evil.
When I was younger, I didn't know I was. Kind of was just so, I want to be a photographer. I want to take pictures. I'll shoot anything. You know, like I just wanted to be liked when I was in my 20s. I just wanted, because I was new to LA and I moved here not knowing one person, not one person. And I got the best job in the world and met to this day, my big brother. I met him the day I moved to LA and he gave me the best advice and it's stuck with me ever since. So I'm all about, you know, the big picture. I'm the long term. I do believe in certain things. I always tell people I have certain quotes that I live by, certain experiences, certain mentor, like to this day, like it's just where I'm at. And these days I'm just trying to pass it on to everybody else. But I like to tell people, like going back to like 91, I saw what was happening to the music world. You know what I mean? I saw this shift and I knew everybody at the label, every label, every manager, I knew everybody. If I didn't, they knew me. So it was kind of interesting to watch. My joke to everybody always is I went from all those bands being poor, poor, poor musicians. By the beginning of 92, they were all millionaires. Millionaires.
And you saw this coming?
Yeah, I kind of saw
it. It was obvious?
Yeah, with certain bands, yeah. Some were surprised me. Honestly, but most of them I saw happening.
Who's
the first time? The first time I saw Pearl Jam play, which was at that CMJ thing, I knew. I was like, and I remember taking my agent. My agent at the time in New York City. I can look up the dates. I know everything. I have to keep
Roseland, November.
Yeah, Roseland. I took my agents to that. Well, got them into that show. I was shooting it and stuff, and we met for drinks afterwards. And they were like, "What the fuck was that?" And I was like, "Yeah, they're gonna be something." You know, so that was interesting in itself, but like watching a lot of that. And then when Lollapalooza started going to the crowds, you know, going, okay. You know, in LA, we were all thought we were alternative or punk rock but you realize, oh my God, a lot of freaks are out there. Every city you went in, there's a bunch of freaks, right? Like, you know, there's a lot of Mohawks every city. Well, has a Mohawk.
There's no internet then, Chris. So no one really knew other pockets having the same kind of freaks.
Yeah. So it was interesting. So that was a major shift. I don't know, think it'll ever happen again, but it was a good one. I don't know if I'm answering your questions. I'm sorry.
No, you are. You're answering questions that we haven't even asked yet.
Dumb sidebar. So when I was a kid, my grandfather was a police detective in the 40s, right? And when the first photos I saw were at 5 years old were crime scenes and dead bodies. Okay. So he used to tell us the same fucking stories all the time, how he solved this crime and over and oh, every time that photo album came out, you had to hear the same story. So for 50 years later, I'm telling my friends, I don't want to get in that position where I've had a cutoff point. I go 65. I stop talking about music. I want to be that photographer sitting on my front porch at 70 going, yeah, kids, you know, there was a time I shot Nirvana. Cause today my friends tell me all the time, shut the fuck up, Cuffaro. We don't want to. So my joke now is next year when you say, Chris, tell us about Pearl Jam. I go, just go to the app. The story's right there.
So I want to stick on that real quick. We're jumping around the time.
I know.
So you're seeing these bands in 91. You're following, you're on tour basically with Pearl Jam. And Chili Peppers are there and Pumpkins are there. And you're shooting Soundgarden and you're shooting Alice in Chains and Candlebox. And so you see these bands and you're like, okay, I think they're going to take off. I think I can see this band. What are these guys like before they hit that? What are they like off stage? Are they just a bunch of jokers, a bunch of kids? Or do you see them, the wheels already starting to spin, say, I can tell that they are recognizing there's a moment happening?
To some of the guys, yes. Some of the guys did not like the pressure. Again, this is, I always like to preface when I talk about this stuff. Number one, I was an outside observer. I always tell people I was a guest.
Your perspective. Yes.
Yeah. My perspective. I was a guest into this Seattle bubble, not even just LA bubble, everything. But I was also a photographer with an eye and I kept my eyes open and I shot what I could shoot. And when things were weird, put the camera away, respect what's going on, you know? So my opinion has always been that it was a slow burn, but I think in the beginning, they were just doing what they loved. And everybody across the board was beyond nice.
Are we talking all bands right now? Who are we talking about?
I'm talking about all the Seattle, that time. I always tell people, everybody was just, Pearl Jam was the best. Nirvana, I loved Kurt. We used to have goofy conversations. Chris was like, just funny, but like in a boring way. Like I always felt like Chris, if I looked like Chris, I would have ruled the world, but he just didn't have that mentality. Everybody was really cool and nice to me. Like I always tell the story about how when I started going to Seattle, they made fun of me. If I went out and met people at the off ramp and I got to know Mudhoney and got to know Charles Peterson, you know, one of my favorite photographers ever. And they just picked on me because, ooh, you're Hollywood. And and then the more I did, the more they kind of let me in. And Bruce Pavitt was another hero of mine. I loved Bruce. Jenny Boddy was the publicist at the time. Like these people like slowly welcomed me in and I got, in a sense, on the inside. And that really helped a lot. And I felt like that made all the difference. And so then they can relax and the walls can come down and then you can see them for who they are. And, I got blessed. You know, I always tell people the moments sitting down at a coffee shop with Lane Staley and his girlfriend at the time and just having coffee with Lane. And you're just like, oh, this is cool. You know, like, why didn't I have an iPhone? I would have taken a selfie.
Chris, you bring up Pearl Jam. It's hard to know how many Pearl Jam fans know this, or rather don't know this, but there was a Jeremy music video before.
Yeah,
Jeremy,
don't get me
music
started.
Video.
I'm not happy
you,
about
you directed it, right? Actually, yes. Right down.
We're talking
to,
about it.
Well, I mean, it was right down the road from where Jason first lived in L.A., Pico and La Cienega. Talk a little bit about just like the genesis of this video, the concept. There's an actual
story. The story behind the video. I have it all on my blogs. So I'll give you the short version of a long story.
Okay.
I did a lot of my work was shooting on stills on music videos. You know, like back in those days, they'd hire a still photographer. That's how I got the famous picture of George Michael Faith. I was the still photographer. I got to work with the best directors in the game: David Fincher, Anton Fuqua, Michael Bay, Tony Scott. Like I'm sitting out next to Tony Scott going, Tony, why are you putting the light over here? And you know, like, what are you doing? You know, can I look through the lens?
He's like, shut up, kid, you're bothering me.
Yeah. You know, I'm working with the best of the best. So, and during that time, you had directors and photographers didn't direct and directors didn't shoot. Everybody stayed in their lane. You know, now everybody can do everything. So when I was thinking about it a lot and I was up in Seattle and I ended up going to the, what was it? The Bad Motor Finger release kind of party thing at the Rock Candy with Eddie and Beth. First, we went to dinner. I took them to dinner, and then we went to the concert, and it was my first time in actual jumping in a mosh pit, which I thought was stupid of me. But we got drunk, you know, had a good night and everything. And I just said to Eddie, you know, I want to direct. After being on sets all these years, I said to him, I want to direct. I think I can do it. And he was the best. At that time, we were good friends. And they were just like, you could do it. You can do it. And I just looked at him and said, well, then how can I be you guys? Mm-hmm. And he goes, yeah, I'll talk to the band. I'll make it happen. Yeah. You know, and he was just so enthused about it. And so I went home back to LA and talked to Kelly Curtis, told him what I wanted to do. And they said, okay. I said, nobody's paying for anything. I'll pay for the whole thing. And so we started setting it up and putting it together. I sold half my guitar collection. I borrowed some money. It cost me about $25,000. Put it all together. And I think it's October 3rd and 4th were the shoot days. So Eddie pitched ideas. I kept it simple. You know, put it all together, got the best DP in the business at the time. Award-winning motherfucker, Martin Coppin. I love the man. He ended up shooting all my videos. And then my producer, Valerie, was the best and got a film crew, not a music video crew, but a film crew. And we did it and shot on 35mm and makes me sad every time I think about it.
Do you want to talk about why it makes you sad? I mean,
I'll say it because I know I have nothing to lose with these people anymore. I mean, I haven't talked to anybody, but basically 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 3 years ago? I have to look at the calendars. I lose time. No, it was more than that, actually. It was before COVID. So, okay, yeah. So maybe 5 years ago. I approached the record label and I asked if they could find the film. I would like to retransfer it because it's 35mm. I'd like to transfer it to 4K and do a 4K version. And the label said, oh, I don't know where the film is. And I was like, okay. And then a couple weeks later, the guy comes calling me back. Dude, I found all the film. And I said, no way. And he goes, yeah. And I said, oh, can I get it? I'll pay no cost to you guys. I'll pay for everything. I just want to do it a 4K version. And he said, I had to get permission from the band. So then I approached the management and said, we'll go ask. And I got a no. Mm. And so, and
no
I,
reason, just no,
no.
If we just talk about the videos side by side, right?
Yeah.
Yours is a lot more full band performance. Yeah. You've got the one actor, you've got some stills and then the, Do you know why is it the label? I assume it's the label. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's a combination. They said, hey, no, Mark Pellington, do this. So
I've heard multiple stories. I was told at the time, the label said to me, I was prepared to eat the money. And they'll reimburse you and you give us the video. And I said, and I was broke. And I said, sure, give me 20. You know, at the time I thought it was 20, but it ended up being 25. So they gave me $20,000 and got it from me. And then I thought they were going to use it. And then they were like, no, we're putting it on the shelf. And then Mark Pellington. And I was told Pellington, I don't know. I'd always wanted to ask Mark because I want to make clear, there's no ill will to any of this. Like, and even then I was like, whatever, it's business. I get it. Mm-hmm. But I think they said to me that Mark was working at MTV or something. And MTV came up, like, you know, typical label stuff. MTV said, hey, if you give us our director shoots and does this thing, we'll make it a big hit. You know, like we'll play it. You know how that kind of goes. So it's okay. I always tell people I'm okay with it. You know, I just wish I can get it now and make a 4K version. I really, really think I think the band would appreciate it. It's part of their history.
It's out there.
Yeah.
You know, people can find it.
So. Yeah, exactly. I still think it's better than Mark's. That's just me. but it's like, I'm proud of it. I always tell people all the time that I'm very, very proud of it for my first music video. I'm very proud of it. It was an incredible experience. Every aspect of it, the relationships I made from it. At that time, I got me into propaganda films. If you know, ever heard of them, they were over on Citrus in like Santa Monica. If you know where that is, a block west of Highland and about two blocks south of Santa Monica. And propaganda like opened doors for me for not just doing stills on videos, but like they helped me. My second video was for a deaf American band for Rick Rubin for $10,000. And they helped, gave me free editing and they supported me in the beginning. It was really cool. Like I would tell people, I look back and that's what I'm doing a lot these days is looking back. I'm so grateful. And I worked my ass off. I sacrificed everything. But I'm grateful because I had incredible support incredible sport. I wouldn't be here.
I'm curious, Chris, because you previously mentioned how you would approach a stranger and show a photo. So you know this photo?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know that photo. Well, that was me, right?
Yeah.
You're kind of like the polar opposite of look at me culture, right?
Yes,
because it's about, hey, this is what I shot. This is not about me. This is the subject of my photograph. But if you think about the advent of social media, we go back, 20 years, there's been this exponential acceleration of this look at me culture.
Right.
Now, I mean, some of it is user vanity. Some of it is like FOMO or whatever you want to call it. Some people love it, some people hate it, but ultimately I think in almost every business, maximizing your work's exposure on social media has really become almost a necessary evil.
Yes.
So, I mean, and we want our interviews to be seen and heard,
right,
obviously,
by
as many people as possible, because we think the conversations are interesting and valuable.
Right.
So we do kind of play that game too, like you mentioned, but we also believe that there's a difference between promoting your work in today's culture and thinking that you're better than everyone else while doing it. So I guess the question is, how do you define and navigate that dichotomy with your art?
So first of all, I just want everybody to know, I am the greatest photographer. The greatest photographer in this apartment. That's it. Okay. I might be on the block, but I haven't met all my neighbors yet. So I don't know. And so I'm old school. Again, I'm old school, right? And I was taught when I was young, let the photos do the talking. You know, there's nothing worse than sitting there telling people about my photos. I hate it. I've always hated it. I was also shy. I was also an introvert. I was a workaholic. So going out getting attention in the 80s and the 90s and the early 2000s was just not who I was. I'm out, look at my photos, bitch. You know, that was me, you know. And I always tell people, I'm only famous with the people I owe money to. They love me. They call me up all the time. How you doing, Chris? Anything good happening? So that's it. You know, it goes back to goal number one, to create the greatest body of work. And I'll put my body of work up to any fucker on the planet today. Music, photography, art, whatever. I'm not saying better or worse, but I've done quite a lot of great stuff. So the way I navigate it all was, look, I'm going to just do the work and hope people notice. Now, that's where greatest hits came in. Starting that was all about, okay, today, what's today's world? I have to say, look at me. Please, please look at me. I'm begging you, look at me. And so I've tried to navigate that. When I started Greatest Hits, my best friend said, you should do a documentary. I said, fuck no. Get in front of the camera? Are you kidding me? Not going to happen. And, you know, it was bad enough I was on an episode of Real World MTV and fucking LA Inc. You know, I don't do front of camera shit. So I asked him, I said, well, if I do this, if I document everything, I go, can I hire an actor to play me? I go, you know, Brad Pitt looks like me. I may even get him to be me. And my friends are like, no, Chris, that's not how documentaries work. And so I said, oh, so that's why, like, you seen me in those story videos and on the website and on the app and stuff like, you have no idea what it took to get past that wall of insecurity to do that. And even to do this is 20 years ago, I wouldn't have come close to this. So I get today's world. I just had a conversation on Clubhouse today with a bunch of photographers about that. Like, I understand today's world. It's not what it was in the 90s, let's say, or the 70s for sure. But like, I get it. So I'm going to play the game. I'm going to play it my way. So creating Greatest Hits was my way of going, all right, bitches, this is who the fuck I am. This is what I've done. Go ahead. Say what you got to say. Mm-hmm. And my joke all the time is, you know, to my photographer friends, and I always tell people, I talk shit. I don't take shit serious. I don't even take me serious. I don't take my work seriously. As far as I'm concerned, I'm a failure. So it's my thing is like, look, I know what I've done. I don't run around. I'm not insecure anymore. When I was a kid, I was, but I'm not anymore. I always say, I'll let the pictures do the talking. You know my photos, whatever. Great. That's it. Good. You know, but where I separate myself from everybody else, every photographer I've ever met, including Richard Avedon, Chris Cornell wrote a song about one of my photos. Nobody can say that.
is it Perry doing this?
Yeah, Jesus Christ Pose. Look at the lyrics. So I always asked Chris for some residuals, and he always said no. I was like, dude. I was like, please? He's like, no, Chris, I'm sorry.
We mentioned Chris's one-time roommate, Eddie Vedder.
Yeah.
Briefly earlier, and you know, you shot them at Roseland, and there's some really cool videos on your website and your app about that experience. And
yeah,
maybe he broke his sprained his hand or something like that. But you know, that's in the I don't, forget the phrase, in utero part of their supernova. Yeah. And I mean, just to see them in that location, because Roseland, I've been to Roseland a few times. I saw Public Enemy, I saw Offspring, I saw Rage, and I saw Slayer all in that venue.
It's a great venue.
Great venue. Wish
great
it was
still size, around. Great space, great energy, great sound.
Now, shooting them there, and you said you brought your agents, and they were like, holy shit. You saw them across that summer, though. Was that the consistent consensus from people that were...
You
were noticing
they won everybody. You got to realize that, you know, Alive was out, but it wasn't a hit in a
It wasn't
sense.
A hit yet.
It was their shows that got them the fans. And then especially when they went on tour with the Pumpkins and the Peppers, right? Blood Sugar Magic comes out. It's blowing up. And I shot them for that. And then, you know, Pearl Jam's, you know, the opening act and gets 30 minutes, you know, and every 30 minutes, everywhere they played, I was in Denver, Dallas, LA, New York, you know, a bunch of places where you could just see the crowd getting won over. And then people talking, Pearl Jam, you know, Pumpkins were great. Chili Peppers were great, but Pumpkins, you know, there was Pearl Jam, which is kind of stealing the show. And, for me, it was fun to watch. I don't think I ever saw a band kind of make that kind of growth in front of my own eyes, in a sense. And that I thought was, there was nothing like it. And I think it was all, you know, our joke was that, you know, Eddie was the goose that laid the golden egg.
If you think about that time, to win crowds over when you're the opening act, there are VH1 specials about how Metallica was opening for Ozzy in 86 and won crowds over. But that was three albums in. Pearl Jam was doing it on their first actual tour,
That's
incredible.
Yeah, that was exactly it. And then to see Pearl Jam doing that, and you got to realize too, especially for Pumpkins, I mean, with the Pumpkins were blowing up at that time as well. Yeah. I mean, I was running around, before the Pumpkins even, people knew who they were, I was running around giving cassettes, recording their first single and giving it to record labels going, you guys got to sign the Smashing Pumpkins. I told three managers, they're like, who the fuck? Cause I would try to pitch bands to everybody. I tried to get Michael Lipman, who's my mentor, the best of everything in my life. I gave Michael the tape of Nirvana Bleach and said, you got to sign this band. And he's like, I was like, oh my God, Michael, you don't see it. But, he had Jane's Addiction for a short bit, but he made all his money off of George Michael. But, you know, so to me, I always look back on those times and just, you know, the memories and again, the photos when things were kind of heating up, being backstage at the Rosen Ballroom with Pearl Jam and talking to Eddie. I did a lot of stuff for a lot of those guys. The first shoot with Nirvana, I bought Dave Grohl 100 pairs of drumsticks on the first shoot because he didn't have any drumsticks. And I was like, how can you be a drummer without drumsticks? Like, well, I did a lot of things.
He famously says in his storyteller book how friggin' broke they were on that tour. Oh, like ridiculously broke on that tour. The Scream tour before he actually went to join Nirvana. So
that day I met Nirvana, they were all hung over and they were like tired and they'd been up all night partying and they had no money, like nothing, like not even a dollar for the meter, you know? And I just remember that. And the last time I saw them was, I think, on the Come As You Are set or something after that. And Chris is telling me how he just bought a house. I said, oh, Chris, congratulations. All you have to do is worry about the house payments. He goes, oh no, we just paid cash for the whole thing. And then the Kurt story, the last time I saw Kurt, he said to me, Chris, you know, what's really weird is when I take $20 out of the ATM and my balance is $50,000. I'm like, oh, Kurt, I'll never know what that's like, but it sounds interesting. Things like that, you know, watching. I told people my joke is that, you know, a band's doing really, really well when you start seeing them perform with nice new clothes.
Mm.
You know, because if you look at the first year of Pearl Jam, I think Eddie wore the same t-shirt.
Oh, yeah.
The whole thing, you know, and the band wore the same shorts, you know, the same Doc Martens.
Charles Peterson was telling us that when they were in Cachquet in Portugal in 96, that he was duct taping his docks because those were his favorite docks. He didn't want them stolen when he jumped into the crowd. So maybe that carried over a little bit.
Yeah, no, but it's funny. I mean, Charles and I have talked about all this kind of stuff. It's just funny to watch the progression of a lot of bands, not just the Seattle ones. I've shot a lot of people. I've shot bands where I'm like, you know, who the fuck are you? And whatever. Hey, nice to see you. And then like a year later, they're like, oh my God, I shot those guys. You know, they just sold. Like Matchbox 20 is one of those bands. Like, I love Rob Thomas. I consider him a friend, actually. I always tell people out of 40 years of doing music, I consider like three guys friends, and he's one of them. But I was shooting Matchbox 20, the first album, and going, okay, these guys, okay, from Florida, whatever. And then, you know, they sold 15 million records on that first one. And I was like,
they pushed a lot of records, didn't they?
Okay.
Yeah.
and the stores are open until 3 a.m. Okay.
Yeah. But
all right.
But Matchbox 20, I've seen them live a couple times, and I like Rob's solo music better. I think Rob. He's one of the nicest guys on the planet. He really, truly is genuinely the best. The best of the best. I've hung out with him many times. He's just genuinely a good guy. And he likes to rescue animals, so that makes it
better. That's good. All right, Chris. So you've got basically just about 50 years, right, in the business?
54.
54?
Yeah, I just turned 64 in April, and I started at 10.
Oh, I guess, yeah. Okay. Well, you've got obviously a ton of photos.
My first business card.
Oh, that's cool.
At 12 years old.
I love that. Outstanding.
So, you know, you said that you're asked most about those who are not with us anymore.
You know,
Chris and George Michael and Scott Weiland and Michael Hutchins.
Go down the list.
You know, why do you think it takes the absence of our musical heroes for us to want to better appreciate them or learn more about them?
That's a good question. I think a lot of it has just to do with when I started Greatest Hits, it's like a lot of things that I do with it. If you look at my sites and what I'm doing, everybody has a music story. This is how I pitched Greatest Hits when I first started it. Mm-hmm. Everybody has a music story. And it starts with I'm going to ask you guys, what was your first concert? Go ahead, Paul.
My first concert?
Not one where your dad or your mom took you to. It has to be the one where you went.
Oh, by yourself. No. Okay.
By myself.
With your friends. You know, your friends, whatever. You went to the first concert. What was your first concert?
It was Pearl Jam.
That's embarrassing. Okay. And you?
mine was The Offspring at the Roseland Ballroom.
Okay.
98.
What was yours? What year? It was Pearl Jam?
My first concert seeing them live was 99, I think, or 2000.
Okay. So I that started the project. And if you see, I have all these videos asking, I've been asking that question of everybody I've ever shot. And I tell guys, if you're single, I always tell guys, if you're going to meet a girl, instead of saying, hey, what's your sign? Just ask them what their first concert was. It's the best opening line.
Does anybody ask what's your sign anymore?
I think they do. They might just say, what's your, you know, Twitter
handle? What was that Mike Damone line? Play Led Zeppelin, side number two. And then it's physical graffiti for some reason. It's a guy couldn't even get the right record.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. But no, but that's the thing. I tell people all the time that like, so that's what the project started. It's like this thing about everybody has a music story. Remember going down to the store to buy the albums, you know? Mm, yeah. And so what my greatest hits project, what I'm trying to do is tap into that nostalgia, those memories. You can put on a song and, you know, let's put on Jeremy and you guys are going to think, oh, the first time I heard Jeremy and what it means. And I'm going to think about, oh, the making the video and being on set. Everybody, these, they call them, my therapist used to say, they're called anchors, images, photos, music, anchors to a memory. It's an anchor. So that's the way I kind of look at a lot of this stuff. It's just the anchor, these memories. And I think a lot of people have these incredible memories of seeing, especially back in the day, we had, you know, MTV and you saw Soundgarden or MTV Unplugged and hearing Alice in Chains for the first time, or go down the hip hop thing, starting to hear Public Enemy and you start hearing fucking gangster rap. And those are our, you know, our childhood memories, right? I mean, so to me, that's a big, big, big thing, is like those memories are a very big deal to a lot of this, I try to tap into is those memories. And you should see when I always tell people when I did the Michael Hutchins exhibition in Australia in 2019, man, It was a bittersweet kind of opening night where everybody was crying. You know, it's like, you're kind of going, this is, I'm making people feel, it's emotional, but they're missing Michael. And it was tough, but, I still love it though. I love that I always say, I love that my pictures bring back memories, good memories and bad memories, but they make some feel. The same thing happened in my George Michael exhibition, man. That became Mecca for George Michael fans all over Australia.
The lovelies.
Yeah, everybody flew from New Zealand to see this exhibition. And I was like, oh my God, I knew he was loved, but this is crazy. So
who's still around then? Who should we be getting ahead of? You know, who should we know about that you've shot that is still, we can still go ask them the question?
First of all, there's only a handful of music. I don't even pay attention to music that much anymore. I'd say, I always tell people 95% of music sucks today. It's just content. It's all it is content. And that's what the world we live, just like photography, it's just content.
Mm-hmm. I have to ask you only because I get how Madison Square Garden, that's the golden goose for you as far as an exhibition is concerned. But for the app, for Greatest Hits, define what success is for this app to you.
Maybe to make a couple bucks eventually. So we have these ideas that we're working on. I can't say, but we're working on some stuff that I really want to take advantage of today's world and technology. And, you know, I've been asked for years to do workshops or master classes. And I did my first like photo talk. I always do artist talks, which is me telling stories and yapping about my life. But photo talk is, let's talk about photography. And I did one in New Zealand, and everybody kind of just was like, loved it. But afterwards, I just felt uncomfortable about it because I don't take it that seriously. But I'd like to do things like that where maybe we do some little educational side to it. Because people always ask me, so give us some photo tips. And I'm all like, go get an 8-ball of cocaine, a couple bottles of champagne, and shoot, have some fun. You know, as my mentor said to me from day one, the rule number one, shut the fuck up and shoot. Okay.
Is that what your best friend on day one in LA told you?
Yeah. Yeah. He told me a lot of things that live to me to this day.
Chris, and, you know, it's like rule, that scene.
Rule number one. It's not what you know, it's who you
know. It's who you know.
Yeah. And it's not who you know, it's who you blow.
If this show wasn't labeled explicit on Apple Podcasts already, it sure is now. All right.
But it's the truth, though. He was right. And I tell people all the time, after 44 years, I fucked all the wrong people because I'm
you know what's funny? Have you seen Love Actually, Chris?
Yes.
Okay. You know when Bill Nye's character goes, kids don't buy drugs.
Yeah.
Become a rock star and they give them to you for free.
Well, that's my thing. Like I tell people, again, I got a million stories, but my rules are simple on drugs is that it's entertainment purposes only. Number one, number two, sharing is caring. That's very important. Always be prepared at all times. I'm dealing with some friends right now who are struggling. I have lots of friends and I've lost a lot of friends. And I've learned, you know, and that's why I tell my young friends that I mentor 20-year-old friends who are just like starting out. And I'm like, pace yourself. You don't need to do everything all at once and do it, you know, and it, you know, you got your whole life ahead of you, you know? So, you know, I just get mad when people do too much and get carried away and get stupid about it. And one of my sayings that I live by that I've taught to, if my interns were here, my friends were here, they would tell you, what do I say? Be crazy. Don't be stupid. You know, crazy is, hey, let's do a couple bumps. Let's have a shot of tequila. Let's have a little fun. Stupid is, now let's get in the car and drive home. No.
Yeah.
I love crazy. I was told I was crazy since I was a kid, and I thought it was a bad thing. But it's not. It's a good thing. You know, and that's why all these musicians I used to shoot and hang out with and do things with and all my crazy friends in general, I'm like, it's like, I love it. I'd rather shoot crazy, fucked up people than, you know, normal. You want me to shoot lawyers and doctors and accountants? Oh, God, no.
Next year, it'll be 55 years of crazy.
Yeah, no, I know. So one of the things I'm working on, like I said, I'm archiving everything. And my goal is to do an exhibition that's more immersive. That's more of all the stuff I have. It sounds crazy, but like, just recently here, the last couple of months, there was a Basquiat exhibition at the Gagosian in Beverly Hills. And I'm a huge Jean-Michel fan. And they had this, you know, it was all about the art he made in LA. So it's all these beautiful pieces. And then they had the center kind of case cabinet in the center. And in it was like these letters and receipts and the paperwork to things that while he was here. And I'm just sitting there shaking my head going, I can do better than this.
Uh-oh, we got props.
He just left the screen to do better
Chris
than
has
this.
Left the screen. He's getting disorganized. Uh-oh. That is not a key to success. No, I'm going to show you something. No one can hear him right now.
No, it's just the best.
He's yelling across the room. Our video friends are having a ball right now. The audio only friends have no clue what's going on.
Well, they're so waiting in bated ball. Anticipation for what's going to come next.
Next week on the show, by the way, guys, is...
This is like a murder podcast.
Well, like this is like, you know...
Here we go.
Here's like...
Uh-oh. Yes.
It wasn't in that folder.
Yes.
It wasn't there.
I'm so glad it wasn't.
Every ticket stub I've ever had.
Love it.
Oh, nice. I have the same thing for every movie stub going back to like.
Really?
I mean, oh yeah, early 90s.
I've got like concerts and sporting events.
No, I've got like True Lies, somewhere. Braveheart. I mean, I've got stubs going back.
Don't look at the price of admission. It'll make you sad. So
yeah. Like an example, I have all these. This is a job folder from a job. Scott Weiland. This is my shoot folder to Scott Weiland. Inside
into
the folder.
Into the mic, Chris.
Okay. This is my folder for Scott Weiland.
Yeah.
So inside the folder are the Polaroids from the shoot.
Nice. Oh, wow. Look at Scott.
Love it. Love it.
So I have all that stuff. The receipts. I have all that stuff.
You can do better.
This is like the film log to the shoot.
I'll tell you what, Chris. I can't wait to put my my Google lens on and dive in an immersive world of Scott Weiland's receipts.
The reason we need Madison Square Garden is to fit all this stuff. Exactly.
Like, you know, it's like, but this is like, but again, I always tell people, I can tell you what I was doing 30 years ago today if you want. I can look shit up. I've been keeping track.
Okay, do it.
Okay, I'll do it. But like, look, here's like, I'm trying to find something.
June 13th, recording this early, guys.
No what doubt. This is No Doubt.
No Doubt. Beautiful.
In New York City.
There's no doubt you can pull up the receipts from June 13th.
Yeah, well, and the Polaroids. 1994.
But it's like, I've always just had this stuff, you know, like, it's like, oh, this is my stuff, my life, you know? And
yeah,
it's crazy. And you
He's
guys
walking away again. Here. He's walking away. This is an anchor point.
Oh, this is better than me dropping my pen. Are you kidding me?
Let's all look at Chris's ass.
What do you got there?
This is the first shoot with Nirvana.
Love it.
Oh, wow.
March 30th, 1991.
Love it.
So inside.
Have they even recorded Nevermind yet?
Is it Bleach Era?
Because that came out in August. Or
like, here's the proof sheets.
Wow. Oh, man.
You know, the proof sheets to the famous photos of them sitting on the dumpster.
So you were down here at Sound City? Or is this afterwards?
This is in Seattle.
Oh, this is not the recording. Okay, yeah. So you said you did some recording sessions.
So I have all that stuff. I have paperwork, my journals. I have all this tons and tons of stuff. I have my, you know, just crazy.
So you want to digitize all of that, Chris?
I've been doing this for years.
That's great. You should.
What year are you up to?
It's not about what year I'm up to, because I'm just doing it different ways and different things and whatever I got time for.
I see.
But it's going to take me another couple years at least. Because I have this goal of mine is to, you know, kind of put a bow on greatest hits and hopefully, you know, go to my next chapter of my life, which I hope is television. I'm working on a TV series right now.
I was going to ask you about that, because that you had a documentary going along with it. You turned into a docu-series.
Well, there's that happening. Two series. I'm trying to work on that one. I'm trying to turn it into a TV series, but I think it's going to might stick to being a documentary. We've been filming everything, every exhibition. And we're doing a grunge exhibition, I think, in September in Texas. And we're talking about Pearl Jam exhibitions. We're talking about all sorts of things. So I'm going to keep going for, I think, another couple of years, I hope. And then do other things, I hope.
Well, I'm super stoked that you're doing this and giving the people what they want, giving the people the stories behind. He's walking away. I was mid compliment. He's like, go fuck yourself. I'm going to go check out this bin over here to my left.
Well, this is all the Pearl Jam fans, right?
This is the core audience is Pearl Jam fans. We appreciate everything.
This.
Uh-oh. Where's he going? This is my pink slip. Sorry. Where'd he go? He's out of frame, kids. Here he comes.
Sorry,
kids. Gave you time to go pee.
The audio only kids are like, what's going on right now? The video kids are like, oh, I saw
they're loving it. They're loving it.
So this is when I was in Hawaii with Beth.
Mm-hmm. For Jane's addiction. Jane's addiction. Yeah.
I pick her up at the airport because I got there before her, and she hands me this little box. Can you see that? Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And inside the box was the actual article about Jeremy killing himself that Eddie wrote the song from.
Wow.
With a little note in it to inspire me. Here's the article, Chris, to plant some seeds.
Is that that's the actual
piece of paper from Eddie to me.
Wow. Yeah. Chris. Well, I don't want to burn any bridges with anybody, but
$10 million if anybody wants to buy it.
Well, here's what you do, Chris. Here's what you do. I'm not advocating this. I'm just saying it's an idea. You could offer trading that for the footage.
No, they probably wouldn't want to do it.
Okay.
They'd be like, go away, Chris. But that's the actual article.
I'm just saying. I mean,
and
it was an idea.
I have all sorts of other goodies. Chris Cornell gave me a Poncier demo tape that was gifted.
Really?
To me. Yeah. So I want to do that as part of, like, I want to do this massive end of the greatest hits exhibition where it's going to be. And I was just talking to somebody 2 days ago about, you know, how can we tie in projections and, you know, and screens and, like, you know, all this stuff that we can do in the ultimate, I call it the ultimate Chris Cuffaro greatest hits, you know, the ultimate thing. So yeah, again, I always tell everybody what I've done so far is amazing, I think, but you know, I've done it with my hands tied behind my back with, you know, small budgets. I always tell people, you give me, you know, $10 million and I'll paint, you know, murals all over the world. You know, we wanted to do this. We've wanted every idea I've had. It's like, we've done a lot of them, but I've had big ideas.
Well the irony is Tony Scott, Fincher, Fuqua, they all started off directing music videos and then parlayed that into features.
So. Yeah, but exactly. They're smarter than me though. I'm not that smart. I always tell people like, why did I want to do photography? What a idiot I was, because I should have stayed in San Jose, right? And gotten a job in Silicon Valley in like the 70s. And I could have been best friends with Steve Jobs. We would have hung out and did some fun shit. I would have been Apple employee number 4. And I would have ruled the world.
Chris, would your soul have been fulfilled though?
Yes. I would have bought another one. Okay. I would have bought another.
Fill it with gold bullion.
But no, I had this stupid dream to go take pictures of naked girls. I was like, I want to go to
That's every 10-year-old's dream, my friend.
I know, but I was stupid. I was subscribing to Playboy at 10. It was a little too early. And I thought,
I blame Bo Derek.
I don't know. I blame Playboy magazine.
Blast
you, Hugh.
Yeah. It was my favorite photographer was a photographer named Ken Marcus. He was God.
We have driven off of the road onto a dirt
path. I know. I'm sorry. I told you guys I warned you.
No. I'm glad.
I just got interviewed by Spin Magazine a couple weeks ago. My friend's the editor. They're bringing it back. Hard copies back.
I saw that. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're bringing that back and my Bob Guccino Jr.'s back at it, which I love. And the editor and they doing an interview thing with me. And we talked for 4 hours.
He left
her going, I need to come back and do more. I'm like, what else do you want to know? I'm at that point in my life right now where, and it's been this way for the last 10 years, I've lived my dream 100 times over. No lie. I can show you shit that I was talking about when I was a kid. You know, I want to do this. And I've done it 100 times over. And so now my goal for the last 10 years is I'm just helping everybody else live their dreams, whether it's photographers, musicians, anything. I'm like, what do you need? What can I do? My wisdom, my advice, whatever it is, I'm out trying to help people live their dreams because I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the help that I got. It's my job to pass it forward, you know, and that's what I do.
Yeah.
And trying to stay sane and trying to pay my bills is not easy. I'm poor, but that's never stopped me before.
Chris, you're rich in memories and naked ladies behind you.
Oh, I know. Those are my girls.
Chris Cuffaro, so many good times. We have.
No, we talk too much. I'm sorry.
We could go another 5 hours. We could beat the Spin magazine record.
Yes, we're not going to. You can call me back in a month or so going, Chris, let's do part 2. And then we can do it easily. I mean, I'm not lying. I get this all the time.
No, I believe you.
I I was in, when I was last in Australia, this people brought me into the studio, the whole thing for a radio interview. And then they're like 15 minutes to commercial break. They're like, we need you to stay longer. And I said, okay. And they go, but we can't, we got next, you know, I was like,
we're gonna lose all the money.
Yeah.
Speaking of money, go download that free app. Cuffaro hits. He'll figure out a way to monetize it at some point.
Yeah.
ChrisCuffaro.com. You got Cuffaro Hits. You got Cuffaro 50.
You can always buy prints.
That's true. Go buy prints.
Get your favorite, you know, Nirvana photo or Alice in Chains or Pearl, whoever. The photo that sells the most of Pearl Jam nowadays is the Eddie flipping the bird.
Yeah.
That's the one sells the most right now. And I just actually got an order for one today. And that was shot at the first year Lollapalooza, first year with James. The last show was in Seattle. We bought 4 40-ounce King Cobras and got drunk. Snuck them in my camera bag. Snuck them in my camera bag and went backstage. And I introduced Eddie
to lens. It's a lens, sir.
Yeah, but I introduced Eddie to all the bands, like Susie and the Banshees and Rollins and, you know, Janes, and I'm like, this is Eddie from Pearl Jam. And they're like, who, what? Who, don't know. What are you talking about?
Fast forward 6 months.
Yeah, like the next year, they're, you know. I just remember everybody's reaction, like, Chris, what are you bringing these guys back here for? I'm like, but it's Eddie from Pearl Jam. And
thank you for, I mean, Jesus Christ's pose, so much. The time today, obviously. Yeah. But the stories, the memories that you've captured at your own expense most of the time, and just allowing us to kind of have these little wormholes into the bands that we love, whether it's Pearl Jam or not Pearl Jam. So just, yeah, exactly. So just a big thank you from me, and I think Paul as well.
No, thank you guys. Like I said, I'm always around. People do this to me all the time. Like I always tell you, ever can't find somebody to talk, just hey, let's get Chris on.
Until next year.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I'm serious. Like people are like, oh my God, we ran out of people. And like, let's go get Chris. He's got more to talk about. Let's talk about the year 1984. And I'm like, okay, good. Let's go.
Let me get my journals.
Exactly. Let me open up a book. Thank you guys. I appreciate it.
That's been a pleasure, Chris.
Thank you.
And breathe. Stories.
Stories galore.
You know, we could keep talking to Chris for days, quite literally, mostly because of him. And he would tell you that.
And there's an endless well of stories.
And you can find a lot of those stories on CuffaroPhotos.com, the greatest hits app that he has. Mm-hmm. When he says he has stories and the pictures to prove it, he's not kidding. So get that app, go to the website, watch the videos, read the blog posts from athletes to musicians, actors, everybody in between. What a career. And a super nice guy, if not a bit sarcastic, but I like that. I'm into that kind of thing. So he was a lot of fun to talk to. And thank you, Chris, for coming on.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Last chance saloon, guys, for the June fundraiser. It's for the Trevor Project. The QR code is on your screen right now to donate a few bucks to support the LGBTQ+ community here in the Pride Month of June. The link is also in the description of this show and also a link in our Instagram bio. Click on that link, tap on that link, throw a few bucks. Five or more gets you the sticker and pin pack. I've got my props this time around. Here they are. We'll mail them to you. And if you want to buy a shirt like the one I'm wearing, $5 off of that. Otherwise, if you want to support the show on Patreon, tons of extra content. There will be some from this video, I can assure you.
Oh, most definitely.
And we've got the giveaways, this month's giveaway for our patrons. Like I said at the top of the show, Long Road, this copy, this exact book from Stephen Hayden. That's the show, guys. We'll be back next week. Next week's guest, graphic artist, illustrator, cartoonist, Ames brother, legend, Ward Sutton. Very excited about that chat. Oh my God. Paul's got nothing. Okay.
No, I'm thrilled. I'm very excited to have that conversation. There is some, iconic art from that man. So
absolutely.
So we'll get into that. I would imagine many of you listening probably have some of it on your wall.
That is true. Unfortunately, I don't have any on my wall. I might have to correct that at some point. Yeah. But these are all shows I've been to, and I never got to go to a show when he did a poster. So that's why I wore it. I'm so sorry. But we will get into all the posters that are not on my wall and all of his editorial cartoons and everything else with Ward next week on this show. And until then, you've been listening to and watching
The State of Love and Trust.